Scarasco, I'm pretty confident you are quite sure that Euskeda is going to become the language of the future, right? But since we are still living in the present now, I will be speaking the language of the past for the moment, namely English. I was required by the local organizers to address, I know I don't have to convince the campaigners, the activists. Rather, we need to have on board, in the same platform, also the decision makers. And so basically, we have to see how planning waste management, given the current European regulatory context, is very much in line with most of the principles of the zero waste vision, which is basically what I do in most of my professional commitments. I work as a strategist, I provide support to the local communities, to the European Union, to the national governments, in order to try and define the strategies for waste management. But let me go stepwise. First important thing to be noticed is, zero waste is rather a travel and not a destination. I mean, what matters most in zero waste is not the final number, which is important anyway, it's worthwhile, zero. But the most important is the continued effort, the continued commitment to get there. If we still have got some residual waste, we want to see what is in there and how we can do in order to optimize and maximize separate collection, recycling, composting, waste reduction, and so on and so forth. But in order to do that, we need to keep the system flexible. The system needs flexibility. Also, what is on the agenda for the decision makers? Because we have to convince them today. First of all, apologies. This is the never-ending struggle, Windows against Macintosh. Sometimes you will have some a little bit weird transitional effects in my presentation. Apologies for that. Blame it on Steve Jobs and not on me. Anyway, the decision makers, they have to plan waste management in a changing regulatory scenario. The regulatory framework at European level is changing more and more, faster and faster, and it is going our direction. Therefore, we need to make them aware that they have to make the proper choices, because once they have got infrastructure, infrastructure will be there for 20 years to come. And we need to keep the system flexible. Oh, apologies. Intensive separate collection. Is it possible intensive separate collection in large cities? Yeah, already Paul Connett gave you quite a few spot informations concerning separate collection in quite a few towns. I will reinforce it in order to make you even more confident. Then, after reduction and separate collection, we still have got some residual waste. What is the amount and the composition of residual waste? How can we play with that? And therefore, we have to fine-tune the options for residual waste in order to be able to accommodate for further increase, further growth of separate collection, recycling, composting, and waste prevention programs. Oh my God. Concerning the regulatory context at European level, we have got a few main drivers, namely the Waste Framework Directive, according to which we will have to provide at least 50% material recovery. And there's also a mandate on member states to prepare some waste prevention programs. So waste prevention is becoming a lively part of waste management. It was not until a few years ago. But now we will have to consider in local strategies also waste prevention. We have got the packaging directive, which embeds the principles of extended producer responsibility. And this also gives us the recycling targets, which are different for different types of materials. And we have got the landfill directive, which is very important, and I will have to dwell it a little bit, because it tells us that we have to divert as much as biodegradable waste as possible from landfills, but it also gives us an obligation on pretreatment of residual waste. And this is basically what the decision makers are most concerned about, because they say, okay, what if I get to 70% and the remainder 30% more? The Dutch answer, the Danish answer is, okay, incineration. But this is precisely what we want to avoid. We want to skip incineration. Is there any possible alternative treatment for residual waste? I'm pretty sure you understand. I will tell you, yes, there is. Okay.
So there is this common tendency across Europe to reduce further and further reliance on landfilling. These are in the old Central Western Europe, the kilograms per inhabitant and year of waste sent to landfilling. Of course, there is an attempt by the industry, is it me? There is an attempt by part of the industry to hijack the zero waste concept towards zero landfilling. And you know what? It blends. It blends, certainly, some recycling, but it also considers incineration. Now, we have to go lower and lower with reliance on landfilling, but we have to consider alternatives to incineration. And basically, the main message coming from the European directive is, let's make Europe a material recycling society. Not just to make me happy, to make Paul happy, to make you happy, because we are environmentalists, you know. But also on account of occupational implications, create jobs, and geopolitical implications, because we have got a resource scarcity crisis which is coming up, just because China and India, they have got growing economies and they are exerting a growing pressure on the international market for primary raw materials. So it's wiser to take a look at what's still in our buckets, whether there is in our waste some material to be extracted and to be reused into our industrial processes. The other key message is decoupling the economic growth and the waste growth. We have to stop waste from increasing, and rather we have to try and decrease it. And yeah, when it comes, oh, this is also a very important message which was lately forwarded by the European Parliament. It adopted a resolution a few weeks ago on April the 20th, calling on the Commission to revise the Environmental Action Programme, and it states, we should set more ambitious prevention, reuse, and recycling targets, including a net decrease in waste generation. So the regulatory drivers in the near future, in the next years to come, will still look different from what they are now. And we have to keep the system able to allow further growth in separation, recycling, composting, and waste prevention. So we need flexible options also for the management of residual waste. Well, there are some ready effect actions. You know, when it comes to waste prevention, normally we say there's some industrial responsibility on that. Eco-design is important. But also there is something that the communities may do at the local level right away. Home composting, sustainable event management. Don't use the throwaway cutlery and dishes. Use reusable or compostable ones. Tap water, the cloth nappies. We have got a huge amount of nappies in residual waste because residual waste, as Paul was saying, concentrates all the mistakes. And if we have got 5% nappies in municipal solid waste and residual waste is only 1/3 of the starting amount, it will treble the percentage in residual waste. It will become 15% nappies in residual waste. And then de-assimilation. De-assimilation, you don't need to do anything else but taking the big containers off the roads. Because once you take the big containers off the roads, you won't have any further industrial waste delivered into the municipal solid waste management system. And this is what happened, for instance, in Capannori. Capannori had these very big road containers, 3.2 cubic meters, lots of industrial and commercial waste delivered into municipal solid waste. And when they introduced curbside collection, puerta a puerta, porta a porta in Catalonia and Italy, curbside in England, basically getting rid of the big road containers, they got rid of industrial waste, 20% less of waste to be dealt with, 20% less. Okay, what does it take to get there? Because we are given more and more ambitious material recovery targets at European level, and we have got some waste plans which are foreseeing increasing recycling rates. But we know that in order to go very high in separate collection and material recovery, we need to implement curbside collection, and this has to cover also the organics. Without the organics, you know, still in Europe, and above all in Southern Europe, the organics are still the majority of municipal solid waste, between 25-30% up to 50% in southern regions in Italy, in Spain, and so on and so forth. And so it's important also to include the organics in separate collection programs. But in order to make you confident, because you say, yeah, we know Usurville is doing very well. We know Hernani is doing very well. But what about San Sebastian? What about Madrid? What about Barcelona? Okay, let's take a look. Probably, you know, this was the new European map which was drawn by The Economist. It's the very important magazine about politics, economy, and so on. And they were grouping together the different European countries by similarity in attitudes, in economics, and so on. For instance, they put Poland aside Ireland because they said, yeah, there's many Polish people going there to work as plumbers. Or England near Portugal because they go playing golf in Portugal in summertime. And so they say, we make the trip shorter. But let me draw your attention to this one. They totally cut off southern Italy from Europe because they said it's, you know, bordello. They call it bordello. Bordello is not a nice word. You know, dirty house. Or prostitution, something messy. Messy. As if Italy was not part of Europe because they said, yeah, it's messy. Nothing works there. Well, at least as far as waste management is concerned, yes, Salerno. Then, of course, Paul gave you the timeline for that, and he said in 1 year, but 1 year was since planning until full coverage of the population. But in those neighborhoods where curbside collection was implemented, the first day of collection, they went up to 75%. It's the first day. It doesn't take one century. It's the first day. And organics play a very big role in this respect. Of course, it needs adaptation to the high-rise buildings, but it may be done. And experiences are there. For instance, Turin, which is the fourth biggest town in Italy, 1 million inhabitants, they already cover by now 60% of the population. That was reporting still 45%, but now it's 60% of the population with curbside collection. And in those neighborhoods having curbside collection, the separate collection rate is around 60%. In the other ones, it's around 25%. So it may be done. Okay, we may have some problems with housing, types of dwellings, but solutions are there, creativity is there in order to give the proper solutions to the specific problems. But I have to tell you about residual waste management. Okay, first of all, so far we have been talking and we have been benchmarking separate collection in terms of separate collection rates, percentages. 50%, 60%, 70%, 80%, 86% Usurville, Rofrano near Naples, 92%. No, but it was a very small village. That was impressive what I saw yesterday in Usurville and in Hernani because they are remarkably bigger than Rofrano. But anyway, Capannori itself, after implementing paper bag systems, is now at 91% in the neighborhood, which is covered by paper bag. 91%. However, please remember that minimization of residual waste is a matter of blending separate collection and waste prevention. And if we only focus on separate collection, some mayors might say, okay, why should I be promoting home composting? It's better for me to have it separately collected in order to maximize the recycling rates.